Father, we thank you for your grace, your mercy. It is a privilege, O Father, to know you. And we ask, O God, that even as your word is shared and your word comes forth through your Holy Spirit, that you bring an awareness of the presence of God, an awareness and a consciousness of your presence, your divine presence that changes and transforms our life. For in you we live, we move, and we have our being. There is no other God but you, Father, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, and our Father. We ask, God, that as we see this truth, that has always been one of the greatest truths of the Bible, that we will understand our place on this earth. We understand your plans on this earth. For your ways are not our ways. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. They are always higher and greater. We ask, O God, that you would lift us up into the heavenly perspective. We are already there in your spirit, but our souls and our minds and our bodies need to see all things from heaven's perspective. Help us, O Father, to walk the way Jesus walked on earth. We know it is possible because we have the same spirit that he has, and also the resurrected spirit that is there since Christ rose from the dead. We have you as our Father, and we have the place and the redemption that Jesus brought us to, where he said he brings us to the place where he has been with you even before the ages began. So here we are in this time, in this dispensation, looking forward towards the fullness of your presence in us, your church, and in us, your temple. Fill this temple with your glory. Fill this temple with your fullness, as you have said and declared in Ephesians 1, 2, and 3, that you are building this temple into a habitation of God. And we believe it is not just a mini habitation, nor a minor one, nor a lesser one, but you are building a habitation on earth that is equal to your habitation in heaven. That all the earth will see the glory of the Lord in your temple. We, your temple, glorify you. Strengthen the angels that work with us, all the spirit beings, and all of the interesting creatures of the divine heaven, that work and establish upon us and with us this living temple, this new Jerusalem that you are to dwell in. Let new Jerusalem in this side of the universe reflect the new Jerusalem in new heaven, new earth. May we be the best reflection of all your glory, of the glory of the Lamb, and cause even this life and this place in the universe to be transformed. We ask not just for the transformation of our spirit, souls, and bodies. We ask for the transformation of the atmosphere around us. For we are not of the earth, we are of heaven. We ask for the transformation around us, yes, of the laws of this earth. For we are above the elementary principles of the earth. Yes. Let the very air we breathe, let the very earth we stand on be transformed. For even all the earth groan and cry out for the manifestation of the sons of God. All the earth beneath us is looking to support the manifestations of the sons of the living God. We are your sons, and we thank you for that. But we know the path towards it is not the path that Gentiles, humans, and the people of the earth think it is. Nor is the path that the Pharisees of our modern era, the traditional churches, and traditional Christian thinking, they've been locked into the wrong doctrine, locked into the wrong principle, locked into the wrong theology and wrong belief system. Break free, everyone, by the power of your word, and let your word go forth with might and power, such that not even a mountain can stand against your word, and no devil or demon or fallen angel can stand against your living word. Let your light be so bright as to be seven times brighter than the sun. We thank you, Father, for this that you do. Bless all the angels that work with us so diligently. Thank you for your great patience upon our lives. We covenant to give you all the glory, worship, and honor. For unto this purpose we were born. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name. And everyone say, Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, as we look at understanding suffering, there is another area we want to consider. We build it week by week. And not only that, we find that in many churches, they do not teach systematically. Every Sunday is a different topic in many places. And also, expository teaching is not much done in many churches. They don't go line upon line, precept upon precept, or go through the Bible. But we are doing that on Bible study night. One of the main things that we want to do is to differentiate between suffering for Jesus and the redemptive suffering of our Lord. Now, Jesus did two things for us. Jesus, in some of his sufferings, we will relate to him and do. But Jesus, in his sufferings on the cross, what I call atonement suffering, that one none of us can do, none of us should do, none of us are qualified. One is atonement suffering. The other is what I would classify is just suffering, the sufferings, the fellowship of his sufferings. So the word fellowship, let me put the F somewhere there, fellowship of his sufferings. There are two different things. We should know that. But in case some of us were hearing this message on suffering, we have a question. Okay, Christ suffered for us, why should we suffer? See, it's statements like that that show the lack of theology and the lack of teaching. When I was in Bible school, one of my professors, who was a Greek professor, and he's quite an intellectual man, very clever, smart man. But because of a lack of experience in the gifts of the Spirit, he lumped all the gifts of the Spirit, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, about 20 over gifts. So he would put, like, for example, all the 9 gifts of the Spirit, 1 to 9, and then all the fivefold ministry from 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, and then he would find other gifts in Romans, chapter 12, and leads and give administration, give for help, gives for sign. So he lists everywhere that there's a mentioned gift, and he come up with 20 other gifts. He say, okay, these are all the gifts of the Spirit. Lump everything together. You know, the habit of lumping everything together, firstly, it's not very systematic. And it's just like, for example, if I were to go to your house and look into your fridge, I'm sure your fridge is organized properly. The vegetable section, the fruit is one section. The meats are a different section. The ice cream is a different section. Your fridge is organized, even though the whole thing can be classified as food. So food is not just lumped together. And the same. In Singapore, you don't have as much necessity for thick clothing. But if you live in a country, let's say in Canberra, Australia, where we have four seasons, you would have winter clothes and summer clothes. And then you have spring and autumn clothes, which is you can put in one section together because they're about the same temperature. Except that sometimes autumn is a bit more windy, so you have windbreakers, which is different from your winter jackets. And so you will have all the different clothings organized by section. I know some people even organize their clothing by colors. And all that, so this color, that color, and some people will organize their clothing by type of clothing. And in case you don't realize it, certain type of clothing are not meant for hanging. Cotton clothing and different clothing you could hang. But like, for example, knitted clothing like this, if you hang them, it actually spoils the clothing on the shoulder areas. And so after a few washings, I realized, okay, if I hang them to dry, they will have this shoulder lump coming up. Because of the weight, it pulls down, and it's stretchable clothing. So then I realized, okay, I'm not going to hang them that way. So I hang them half. So the line is in the middle, and it stretches the middle section rather than stretch the shoulders. Because if you keep doing that, your shoulder areas go, and it becomes very loose on the shoulder, so the neck will grow very big. And so this type of clothing, it's best not to hang them even when they're dry in your cupboard. It's best to fold them. And there's a different technique. Some people fold flat and then put it there. And I've tried both ways. The other way of folding is you fold and then you roll them up. And so I'm trying to still debate which takes less space and which is easier to access. Let me check. For example, let's say Alex, you got that kind of shirt that you have, the one that you're wearing, okay? So do you hang them when they are in the cupboard, or do you fold them and put flat in the drawers?
This one
Do I have to ask Mrs. Smart Alex? You hang it. Okay. And do you have any clothes that you fold flat?
Yes, I do.
Okay. What type of clothes are they?
Clothes that I use for brisk walking.
T-shirts you fold, you don't hang. Okay, and you fold them flat, right? There are many ways of folding. You could fold this way like they sell, or you just fold them into half and quarter, and put the sleeves in. And so, have you tried rolling clothes?
Only when I was in the army.
He's in the army. Okay. So, when you travel, when you read up on that, see, the funny thing is the simplest thing in life, we didn't know there's more than one way of doing it. Correct? Because you brought up and you're so used to doing some things in some way, you didn't realize there was another way to do it. And then some people who are traveling and they say that when you don't want your clothes not to be with lines and all that to be nice, is to fold it nicely, put it all together and you roll. And so it's a different style of packing different clothes. So it's interesting. I've tried almost every way, still haven't decided which one I like. And so that's about natural thing. So how can we lump everything together? And you know, when you lump something together, you cannot study it properly. But that's a simple illustration. I use the side here to illustrate that, okay, if you lump all the gifts of the Spirit together, it'd be like 1, 2, 3, and up to 20-something, 24 or 30. Some people form 30. And so that's all you're, so you want to study each gift as it is. And you can study 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and all the different gifts. And that's a way of lumping. But there's a different way of organizing the gifts. You could organize the gifts to be, for example, fivefold gifts. The fivefold gifts. So there are five of them. And under the fivefold gifts are the nine gifts of the Spirit. And so for you, the nine qualifies you for the five. So out of the nine, there are three categories. So there's revelation gifts, power gifts, and vocal gifts. So a prophet might have two revelation gifts and a gift of prophecy and one vocal gift. So that qualifies you to be prophet. So there are subsets of that. And then we realize also there's a subset equivalent to what I call this is gift, this is growth. So there's gift of wisdom, there's growing in wisdom, growing in revelation. So there are also nine departments here. And then we realize that from this department, here is the fivefold, which comes from a calling of God. And here are positions in the church that you can grow into. Now when you organize in this way, suddenly you see more revelation. Especially if the classification is correct. And I never learned this at all. I was learning this in a Bible seminary, Baptist seminary. Then as I grew in the Lord, I realized it cannot be organized like that. This is very simplistic. And it looks like, yes, I've organized my clothes. You can organize it better. Winter clothes, spring clothes, summer clothes. And then there are clothes that you wear a few times before you wash. So there's a different section. So you save washing. And your clothes last longer too. Because if after every wash, you know, you wash. And some people who are new to it, like for example, they don't realize that jeans, you don't wash after single wear. Do you? Single wear.
You mean wearing for one day?
Wear one day, then straight away wash. You don't. Because if you do, they're not going to last long. Jeans you could wear a few times before you wash it. And so, all these things, Pastor, you're teaching us about clothes. Jesus teach about parables. So I use clothes parable. Today's clothes parable. And then you assign it to the spiritual things. And then you realize that, like for example, how will it be useful when you travel? When you travel. So if you are a single-use person, I can guarantee you, you go anywhere for 2 weeks, your luggage will be three times my one. You remember one day when we went to Turkey or somewhere, and many of you brought, your luggage. Of course, unless you are like somebody so lovely like Louis who brought cooking things to cook for everybody. But under normal cases, everything is just clothing. So I remember, you know, then somebody said, hey, we're going for a week. And then all I have is just one bag that's small. You say, that's your 1 week of clothing? Yes. And it's not that you're going to smell for the week because you're either that bad, you know, you rewear them, but or you're washing every day. No, that's not quite it. But it's how you organize your things. And you can travel light. And I can assure you, when you have to go into the ministry, you learn to travel light. And you learn how to travel light. And instead of traveling, can you imagine a missionary traveling like an actress or actress? You know, they got 40 bags. I think something is wrong. Even normal people might not travel that much. And some people say, oh, if I got children, you know, there will be. But even that can be organized. Even that can be organized. Because I know I have traveled with kids before. And the most bags we have, total whole family, 2 bags. So it doesn't mean your children, my children got 20 kg, you got 30 kg, second child got 20 kg, you know? And then you bring unnecessary things to and fro. So we realize that the way something is presented can be improved. What did I press on? Okay. And so what we have is, when we look at the doctrine of suffering, a lot of people have not have proper teaching. So when you talk about suffering, they say, suffering, why should we have suffering? Christ redeemed for us. That's still in the average thinking. Do you realize that? That's still in the thinking of many Christians, which we have to correct. There is suffering in which Christ suffer, we can never suffer. That's because it's redemption. He took our sins. The suffering is for redemption. He bought us with His precious blood, with His precious body. He died for us. He died for our sin. He became sin for us so that we can receive the righteousness of God. That's obviously 2 Corinthians 5 verse 21. No one can do that but Jesus. Also in the book of Hebrews, it's all inside. There is also, you know, one sacrifice, only one sacrifice is necessary. Son of Man came, sacrificed once, and that's it. So let me look at the doctrine of the one sacrifice that is necessary only in Christ. In the book of Hebrews, let's choose one. Let's start from 9. Talks about the covenant, the early things are necessary. Then it says here, Christ came as high priest of the good things to come. Then verse 12, not with the blood of goats and calves, but with His own blood He entered the most high place once for all, once for everyone, having obtained eternal redemption. For if the blood of bulls, goats, and the ashes of a heifer, sprinkling the unclean, sanctifies or purifying the flesh, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offer Himself without spot to God, cleanse your conscience from dead works to serve the living God, that we may receive the promise of an inheritance. And so here is everything is about Jesus. He died once for us. He offered Himself. And so He gave verse 27 and 28. And as it is appointed for men to die once, but after this the judgment, so Christ was offered once to bear the sins of many. So there you have it, that at the end of the ages, He appeared, put away sin by the sacrifice of Himself. But the thing that He wants to bring us is into the place of God. So, wait a little note. One sacrifice to bring us to God, to God's, let's say God's dwelling, God's throne. So He does that once. And that one in Hebrews, He have in Ephesians chapter 2, He has redeemed us. And in John chapter 17, in His prayer. So you got Hebrews, you got Ephesians, you have John 17 that talks about Him bringing us to the place in God. In John 14 also, in My Father's house are many mentions. So He is, one is to redeem us on the earth, save us from sin, give us the righteousness of God. The other is to actually bring us everything from heaven. So He stands in between. No one can do that. And there are many details of His suffering and all that He has done. On the other hand, there are some sufferings that Christ suffered that He said we also must suffer. Among them are what He called the baptism of suffering. baptism of suffering, baptism of fire, when he asked his disciples, and so let me highlight the word baptism, but not water baptism. This is a baptism of fire or suffering. When they wanted to see the right hand and left hand, here, Matthew, he asked them, can you be baptized with the baptism which I'm baptized with? And he's talking about the baptism of suffering. They say, we are able. And then he says, okay, you answer correctly, but you still cannot be on my right hand and left hand. That's the baptism of suffering that he talks about. Let's see that. Okay, it's repeated again in Mark. And look, this Luke incident tells you that the baptism is a baptism of suffering. In case some people want to argue what I call technical arguments. Baptism is not necessarily baptism of suffering. Okay, look at what Jesus said in Luke chapter 12, verse 50. But I have a baptism to be baptized with. So what do you think his baptism is? He's already been baptized in water. He's talking about going to the cross, suffering for us. All the things that he endured. How distressed I am till it is accomplished. As far as you and I know, Jesus never went through any water baptism after that. And so he went through a lot of sufferings. And then he continued to talk to us about the suffering. So he did mention to John and James that you will also share the baptism of suffering. Out of your position in God, you will have to suffer for me. And besides that, Jesus uses this word. I hope this modern translation is tribulation, because sometimes they change to persecution. And let's highlight tribulation. And most of it is more in the Gospel of John and other things here. Now obviously, even starting from Matthew 13, he says there are four types of seed that fall down. But then he says, when tribulation or persecution, and it looks like he's illustrating, tribulation is a word, telepsis, and high pressure. But it's also been translated persecution. Whereas persecution here, there's another word for it, diakmos. And that is persecution. And let's say the root word for that, which is different. The other is high pressure. Two words that seem to relate. Okay, let's see the root word where it's from. The root word of the word diakmos is, I'd say persecute, to follow after, figure by implication to be persecuted. Dio is to flee. And, okay, it means to cause to run, to cause to flee, the root word. Diakmos. And something that if you don't move, the pressure is too great. And so, interesting, they got two words. But obviously, from Matthew 13, it's for everyone. Correct? It's for everyone. And from the Gospel of Mark, and even on this, look why the persecution came. What is the persecution or the pressure targeting? It is targeting this. See the word? Because, simple English word. Because, on account of the word. So if you take away the word, the persecution all stops. The persecution is not targeting you. Why you think you're so important? You and I are just containers. The persecution is targeting the word to make you drop the word. Why are you coming after me? It's because of what you're holding, not in your hand, but in your heart. And then suddenly you go, they don't chase you anymore. They're going after that. So, the persecution is targeting the word. Obvious conclusion, since all of us have to receive the word. You have a few interesting things happening. There is a baptism of suffering. There is number one is for, let me remove that and give space. Number one is part of what we are taught of, position. The higher position you have, the greater your persecution. So some of you said, I want to be the highest position in God, in heaven. Oh, hallelujah. The angels hear that prayer, look to the next one. Do they understand what they are praying for? The guardian angels say. And then you are saying, more Lord, more Lord. The guardian angels say, siu siu. What is the Chinese word?
Sao
sao. Sao sao. 一点一点. Yeah, 一点一点. Siu siu, sao sao. My language is very funny. Tampok tampok. Okay. Sedikit. Because we know it not what we ask. Because if all of it came at once, it's unbearable. And so sometimes the guardian angels, God says, if they're taking care of us, and then Lord says, hey, have you informed your charge about all the things they ever go through? Say, Lord, if I inform them, they don't go through. And if the angels will smile, they will smile. So we're going to inform them after they go through. When they going through. He say, what happened? You inform him. Say the head angel to your guardian angel. If I inform them in the first place, they won't be here. I know them. I was with them when they were born. I know their character. And so sometimes God is humorous. He knows how to bring you into a certain place. So for position. We learned last week, there is also a persecution that God permit that has to do with character and reward. Now we realize that there is persecution, tribulation, and persecution because of, let me get a different color, of the word. The word. And then you have another one. This one you can take from Matthew 13. There are many scriptures, so I try to save time and not giving all the scriptures word. But here's another one. There is, can I call it buffeting, which is a type of persecution? Because of revelation. This one Paul mentioned in the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 12. 2 Corinthians, chapter 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 12, and let's just pick one verse. So Paul says, I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. And he says, I know a man in Christ, referring to himself in the third person, 14 years ago, whether in the body I do not know, whether out of the body I do not know, God knows, such a one is brought to the third heaven. We know it's him because suddenly he talks about himself. Verse 7. Lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelation. Because the more revelations you have, the more you must endure so that your character won't become proud. So Paul says, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a fallen angel from Satan. So suddenly his battle is not against demon anymore. His battle is against a fallen angel. And the fallen angel keep on buffeting. What? How does he buffet Paul? Buffet is the word kolaphizo. Kolaphizo. Kolaphizo is a word means to be punched. Like a punching bag. So he directly felt pressure. And maybe as a side effect, he might feel pain physically as a result of his previous persecution, where he's still healing. So he is feeling the punches. And this is the author who say in Ephesians 6 that you can quench the fiery darts with shield of faith. But these are not arrows. These are actual punches. So he was actually enduring that, and he knew God a lot, and then he cannot take it very much because he has to spend so much time in this area until he cried out to God. And then when he cried to God, God says, he cried three times, and it might be a long time between the three times. In the end, God says, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. My strength is made perfect in weakness. Because he felt so weak. And in the end, you know how Paul react? You know, the enemy was using him as a punching bag. Until Paul says, I take pleasure. So he said, okay, punch. And he goes, ha, 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 ha. And then punch again. Ooh, ha, 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 ha. Until Paul take pleasure. Paul was enjoying it. And then the enemy say, the more I do, the more he enjoy. So the fallen angel go and report to the devil. Don't know what to do. Say, why? I sent you there. No. Something changed. Say, what? What changed? Before, each time I punch, he says, ayo. Ah, why? Now I do the exact same thing. He laughs. The more I do, the more he laughs. The more he enjoy. Now he actually say, you know, tickle me this part, tickle me that part. I don't know what to do. And so the devil say, okay lah, don't disturb it anymore. I also cannot stand his laughter. His laughter is so loud that I can hear it even from the depths of hell. You know, and you're not the only one suffering for all their laughter. And remember, God laughs at the enemy. So you realize that the person has progressed. But definitely he went through all these things. And he says in verse 10, I take pleasure. I take pleasure. You know what the word pleasure means, you know? Eudokia. Eudokia means I see it as good. It's good for me. It's like some of us learning to eat some things. One of the foods when I was growing up, I remember my mother used to chop, I don't see in Western countries, it's called bittergourd or whatever it was. And it looks like a cucumber, but it has all these lumps around it. And the lumps are organized in long rows. So it's lumpy, you know, and other big ridges on it. A strange looking vegetable. So my mom used to cook it, normally stir fry, with bean sauce, bean paste, and some other thing. As a young boy, it was very hard to eat. Very hard. I never liked to eat a veggie. So in the end, one fine day, after I was in the seminary and I went to visit some homes, there were this family that did the bittergourd differently. See, it's all in the presentation. This family sliced the bittergourd very thin. And then had a very quick fry. Go psh, and it came out crispy. I had never had crispy bittergourd. Have you seen bittergourd? Ah, another thing to torture you. Okay, besides raw, what was that? Raw broccoli, yes. Okay, raw broccoli. Okay, so it was crispy like what we Malaysians say, keropok, crackers. It was very pleasant. Is it nice? Then after a while of eating it, you get used to the bitter taste. And then I try it at home. Said, bite bittergourd. And after your tongue get trained to the bitterness, then when you go out to eat, and in this, what you call, in Singapore, they have all the mixed rice place, and they have the bittergourd. And I try it, I get back, I could enjoy it now. So now I could eat bittergourd, and I love bittergourd. All because of one training. So there you go. Paul, after he learned the art of how to be weak so that God's strength come. So each time the enemy tried to punch him, he yielded to God. I am weak, but thou art strong. And his timing is such that the enemy is punching him. You know, so as the enemy punches, I am weak, but thou art strong. Every action goes reaction, correct? And if you're strong, if he punches you, he get punched back. I am weak, but thou art strong. Until it was the fallen angel that went blue and black. Report to the master. The master, hey, what happened to you? And says, every time I punch him, I get the same punch back. Say, did he punch you? No, something punched me, my own hand. So, Paul learned to take pleasure. Until he enjoys it. Look at him, he was 10. A man who enjoys infirmities, that is physical weakness. And he enjoys reproaches, that is when people insult him. He's enjoying it now. In needs, sometimes he sacrifices and he don't have enough, and he's still enjoying it. In persecution, in distresses, when people emotionally give up, a distress is you don't know what to do. And Paul is enjoying all these things. For Christ's sake, for when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Here is a man who takes something that nobody wants and makes it an enjoyable thing. That's a fantastic progress. Something changed in Paul. And the enemy will say, take him out of the list. So if you want to be taken out of the list, where the enemy say, no chance, this one wasting our effort. Don't forget, the enemy, fallen angels and all that are limited creatures. They also are limited in time and space. So if they spend all the energy on you, they got less to worry somebody else. So they also have to go by economics of energy and time. They cannot be attacking you 24 hours. Because if the devil is attacking you at that time, then he cannot attack somebody else. So there you go. When he reached that stage, it's a victorious level. So here we have, there is a buffeting because of revelation. And then you have number five things. I will stop at five. We could actually discover more, but five should be sufficient for this series. Number five is for the gospel. For the gospel. That is the one you find in Colossians 1 that I mentioned. So now I put it in form, point 4. You see this side, you see that side. And what you see is, on this side, Christ also did endure for us. See, there are some things that Christ go through that is example for us to go through. Because Jesus said in John chapter 16, in the world you will have received tribulation. In John 15, he says, if the master, if they do this to the master, they will do this to the disciple. So they are saying some things that what he went through, we must go through. But there are some things that what he go through, we cannot do. Because it's a redemption area. And so let me give the scriptures, because everything we build on must have scriptures. We already gave that, but today we give it in this point form. In the book of Colossians, Paul says unto the Colossian church, let me pick the exact words. He likes to glorify God. Here it is, verse 24. I now rejoice in my sufferings. The word suffering is actually from the word patima, passion. And my sufferings for you, and fill up in my flesh what is lacking in the tribulations or persecutions in Christ. Can you see the word telipsis? Telipsis is the same word translated tribulation. So what is lacking in the tribulation or persecution in Christ? For the sake of his body, I'm now suffering. What is this suffering? If we read the context, it is for the gospel. It is for the gospel. And this suffering is to be Christ. Oops, I need to change the color. And it is to be the Christ example, to be Christ to others. God wants to show Christ in you to others. For example, God so loved the world, He gave His only Son. So we know He loves us. If we were to ask you, how do you know God loves us? If you want to quote from Old Testament, you know, He loved the Israelites and all that. There's no greater illustration, and action is louder than words. When God sent His Son, that statement tells us He loves us. Because He has never done that to fallen angels. But He did that for human race. When angels fell, God never sent His Son to be an angel to redeem them. Because they are non-redeemable. But when mankind fell, He sent His only Son. In human form, to die for us. And Jesus showed His love for us by dying for us. It says, scarcely for a righteous man who one die. But for a righteous man, some might die. But for a sinner, nobody will do that. But Jesus did that. And what you have in the fifth point is 1 John 3:16. We lay our lives. God so loved the world in John 3:16 that He gave Himself. In 1 John 3:16, no greater love has any man than to die for another person. And what is being done is that people need to see you, see the gospel through you. Your words are one thing. Your actions is one thing. But being willing to die for them, that is the same message. Because they might say Christ is a historical figure. Even today, some people don't even believe in a historical Christ. But when they see that you love them so much to tell them about God, that you're willing to die, then you have become Christ to them. The fifth point. For the sake of the gospel, you are Christ to them. You keep coming to them. Remember the story of the cross and the switchblade? David Wilkerson keep reaching out to Nicky Cruz. He keep loving him back, although he was a very unlovable person. And there are many stories about how loving people so well. I think John Stott wrote some interesting things about love and how people are touched by love. Even in a natural world, without the gospel, people are touched by human love also. How much more when they're touched by divine love? And especially if the love is given unconditionally. So these are the sufferings we must endure, which is the theology of suffering. These Christ did for us also. He suffered a lot of inconveniences for us. And this one, He suffered the atonement no one can do. So differentiate between this and that. There are many more scriptures to support these 5 points of suffering. And we can prove that it is God's will for all Christians to suffer these 5 things. It is God's perfect will. And it's all right to suffer. And depend on how much you want. But inside there are a few equations that you can do. Like for example, in point one, the higher the position, the greater the suffering. In point two, the greater the transformation, the greater the transformation character, the greater must be the persecution. In point three, tribulations and persecutions are in direct proportion to the word. In point four, the intensity of the buffeting is equal to the intensity of the revelation. Or the depth of the revelation. In point five, the magnitude, the largeness of the area you're going to preach the gospel is proportional to how much you must suffer as Christ to reach those people. So you're going to reach one city, that's let's say X amount of suffering. You're going to reach a whole nation, if the nation has 30 cities and villages that people live in, 30x. If you want to reach to 100 nations, then it's 100 nations times how many x's in each city and nation. So you can see the magnitude of your suffering is greater to reach how many people you want to reach. So if you are asking, a lot of people very clever, they want to ask for soul. God, give me 1 million souls. Are you willing to suffer 1 million equivalent? If you cannot even suffer for one, how can you suffer for 1 million? God gave me 1 billion souls. Are you willing to suffer to love 1 billion souls? How much love do you have? You cannot even love your neighbor. Want to love 1 billion souls? Extend your love. And sometimes God is trying to get you to love more people. And here's the thing. You know, the greatest thing you can do in life is these 2 things. Be transformed until you're as Christ as possible, like Christ. Number 2, win as many people to Jesus as possible. Be a soul winner. Let your life be able to win many souls. Don't just save yourself, save others. Be a soul winner. He that winneth souls is wise. They shine as bright as the stars. So by all means, go and believe God for many souls. When we believe 6 billion souls, we are passing down the anointing of all the 6 billion to each one of you. In total, for the church to win. 2/3 of the planet Earth. But if you are a leader to lead the empire of Christ over 6 billion, you must love, have the love for 6 billion people. The empire of Christ is to a certain extent like a country. You cannot choose. You know, sometimes when I evaluate leaders and place them in positions and I ask them to grow, and part of the growth is this. I evaluate whether a leader can love others whom they find it hard to love before they're actually given an official position. It's like this. If, for example, if you're the prime minister of a country, nobody gets 100% vote, correct? Maybe you got 90% vote, 70% vote. If you get 70% popular vote, do you know 30% not voting for you? But as a prime minister, you're still prime minister 100%. Which means you must still take care of 100%, even if your vote is 55%. The same in here. The kingdom of God does not belong to us. The kingdom of God belongs to Jesus. We are only custodians of the kingdom. And everyone who is in the kingdom is a citizen of Jesus Christ. We never choose the citizens. Jesus chose the citizens and brought them into His kingdom. There are some citizens you don't like, but Jesus loved them. But you work for Jesus, if you work for Jesus, you must learn to love and to like everyone. And you say, oh, I can love them, but I don't like them. Okay, that is a saying among human beings. I can love you, but I don't like you. Give me an example. So you say, well, like, for example, I take care of their food, clothing, and shelter, but I don't want anything to do with them, don't want to talk to them. Then I will ask you the question. Is this the way Jesus loved? Is this how Jesus loved? So then I said, the way you love only is satisfactory in your own eyes. It's satisfactory in human eyes. But you're still using human value. In heaven, now we talk about heaven. In heaven, there is no such thing as I love you but don't like you. So the next time you have a vision book and go to heaven, see whether it's possible to live in heaven and don't like anyone in heaven. No way. I know it exists on the earth. But let's not use worldly standards, earthly standards for heaven. I know that sometimes people are very difficult. But when I have to govern COG with 6 billion people, I have to learn to like them. Now, here's the thing. Why is it so difficult to like some people? What's the difficulty? Can I ask Jesus, Jesus, do you love everyone who's born again in your kingdom? You can hear the answer, right? It's a big resounding yes. Now let's ask him the second question. Jesus, do you like everyone in your kingdom?
Yes.
You can hear yes, sir. Can you hear? Some people can hear yes, sir. Some people hear Jesus say, I don't like their ways, but I still love them. But for Jesus, He likes everyone. Because we use the word like for a willingness to treat them nicely, cordially, and to find something that we can enjoy the time with them. I understand the human concept. The human concept is when we don't like a person, we don't enjoy their company. We don't enjoy being with them. But do you think this is possible for Jesus? Jesus could say, I don't like you, so I do this. At one point in the Old Testament, God don't like the Israelites. And God said to them, in case I destroy you, I will send my angel with you, but I'm not going with you. He told Moses. And Moses said, please go with us. If you don't go with us, we don't want to go. So Moses asked for that. Now, if you look carefully, it is not because God doesn't like them. It is because they underestimate the power of God. And God was saying, if I am with them at their level of disobedience, they will poke me, disobey me, and then justice has to be done, and they will all be killed, and there will be no one left for me to love and like. look carefully. At the superficial level, it looks like God don't like them, so he said, I sent an angel. But you didn't read further. It says that the reason is, at their level, I might end up destroying them because they keep running, disobedient, run under my feet. And then I look at them, I hear a sound. So they keep doing things that destroy themselves, playing with electricity, playing with fire. And I'm full of electricity and fire. And I'm trying not to destroy them. And God never used the word like, by the way. He just says that because of their sin, I cannot be near them lest my power kills them. And I understand the human level of not liking a person is you don't enjoy the company anymore. It is okay on earth, okay in human organization. Yes. In a big human organization, there may be 10,000 employees, a different level, and you can work successfully and you don't care about another department. You might not even like someone in another department, but you can still work together for business. Unfortunately, the kingdom of God is not about productivity alone. It is about character changes. Because something in the character is what vibrates in heaven. The kingdom of God is about being born again with the character of Christ. And that union that you have with everyone. Because the kingdom of God is an organism. An organism must link permanently one with another. Every thought is tied to another. Every heart is tied to one another. There's no way you could not connect. Whereas in the world, you can work with people you don't like and you refuse to connect with them. You just do your job, submit your job. But not possible in the kingdom of God. We are so used to working on the earth like that, that we think we can get away with it. But as I say, if you ask our Lord Jesus that question, you can hear him answer. And that is the true answer. Jesus, do you love everyone? Yes. Jesus, do you like everyone? Yes. Now, I did not say that Jesus is able to do with everyone the way he wants. He comes down to each person's level. But Jesus loves and he likes everyone. Unfortunately, it's a reality of the human life that there are some people we love and some people we like. Some people we choose to love but we don't like. And I'm saying there's a reality of human relationships. But if we want to be one step more perfect, if you want to be perfect, you learn to find something you like. And I'm not asking you to like the devil, fallen angels, or demons. I'm asking you to like humans who are created in God's image originally. They may be twisted, behave like the devil, and I did not ask you to work with them because there are some people you cannot work with. But in your heart, you must have the love of God for them. You must still feel pity for them, compassion for them, empathy for them. And that makes you divine and born of God. If you don't like them, that makes you human. We are called to be above humans. If this message convicts you, put that as a standard to aspire to. And I don't ask that you go there overnight. But at least you remind yourself, to be perfect, I must be there. So we put a higher standard. So this is a general outline to clarify. And actually, this was not the fullness of the sermon I want to bring you in the first service. The fullness of the sermon is, I have questions for you that we want to answer. First question. Okay, let me get this done and get you the first question. First question. Oh, let me get it in black color. You all know Jesus and the 40-day temptation. So the question is, could Jesus do his ministry without passing or having victory in the wilderness? In Matthew chapter 4, in Luke chapter 4, in Mark chapter 1, it says that the Holy Spirit sent Jesus to the wilderness. In Mark it says he drove him there. In Matthew and Luke it says he was led by the Spirit. So our question is, could Jesus have succeeded in his ministry if he didn't go through that? Was that an important requirement? Could he have done the ministry without the 40 days? Okay, let's go to the back seat. Mrs. Smart Alex at the back. Why you point to him?
Thank goodness.
Okay. Colin is saying something?
No.
No?
Because in Hebrews it says that he was tempted in every way. Like,
yes.
So he needs to be...
He needs that compressed 40 days plus all the others.
So that he tasted all the temptations like us.
So, are we all agree that he cannot?
Yes.
Okay, anyone say yes? I would like to listen to your arguments. Nobody yes? So the answer is that he has to go through. So, could Jesus do his ministry without passing the thing? Our answer is no, right? Because of the way the question is raised. So the answer is no, which means he must pass. If he fail, cannot. And in Luke, it does record, when he came back from the wilderness, the power of the Holy Spirit was upon him. Next question. Could Job receive 2 times blessing without his sufferings? You know his sufferings are recorded in the Bible. His sufferings were that he lost all his possessions. He lost all his family and children except for his wife. He lost his health. Nearly died. We know the story of Job, only 42 chapters. But all his disasters began in the first 3 chapters. So the answer, could he have double blessings if he didn't go through that? Yes. Or no? Also no. So we agree. Take away his sufferings, he will remain the same. He is already blessed. So if he didn't go through those things, he could not have double his blessing. And it's exactly double. When you compare chapter 1 with chapter 42, it's exactly double. If there were 6,000 of this certain animal, there are 12,000. If there were 7,000, there were 14,000. So everything is exactly double. Remember, he started from nothing. He has to start all over again from scratch. So we are we agreeable that no, he cannot get it unless he go through that, which means he must go through any descending voices. Okay, so we also say no must suffer. Must suffer. And we ask,
must we suffer?
Coming closer and closer home. Let me put one more person. Could Paul, the apostle, could Paul succeed in his ministry without persecution and suffering? I put short form, suffering. See, here's a little bit harder one. So if we take away all Paul's sufferings after he became a Christian, people try to kill him. Actually, from day one, people want to kill him. 3 years later, people still want to kill him. 40 years later, people still want to kill him. And they make his life miserable. They literally make his life miserable. All the way throughout his life. Only when his life ended, then there's no one to persecute. And they turn their persecution to somebody else. So, could Paul succeed in his ministry without the persecution and suffering? Yes, yes, he can succeed.
No.
Okay, good. We got some descending. So some of you say no. No, he cannot succeed. Okay, let me hear those who say yes.
Because Paul already repented when he was on his way to the Damascus, he met Jesus and his encounter with the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
He already knows that he's with the Lord. So, even without the persecution, his ministry will be even more successful. Because
oh. So, without the persecution, his ministry will be even more successful.
Because he truly loved Jesus and he knows that.
Okay, let me take some of your words. Okay, so you mentioned he already loved Jesus. Loved Jesus.
Because he
encountered
on his way from
Damascus. He encountered Jesus. Okay.
So even if no persecution,
in no persecution, he is more successful. Okay, he encountered Jesus. And so, can I qualify what you define to be success?
For him. Success in the way that spreading the gospel.
Spreading gospel. Spread gospel. Yeah, it's good that you make that point because it gives us something to analyze. Okay, spreading gospel. Okay, let's analyze that. Anybody else say yes? That I get your point. The rest of you are saying no. It's good, you know, that we have something to discuss. Now, let's look at the love that Paul has for Jesus. We know that Paul did love Jesus when he met Jesus. Call him Lord. And Paul at the beginning when he met Jesus, and Paul at the end when he chose to be martyred, we all agree his love must have grown, correct? You agree his love grow. So his love has grown. Based on the Bible, it's not possible to grow in love in Romans 5 without suffering. Not possible. Because love must be tested. Let's say if you fall in love with a sweet Christian girl, okay, and you both love each other, you could provide for her, God bless you, and she takes care of you and loves you. Then you know that you love each other, you're deeply in love, and then one fine day, you hit a bump on the road, you have to change job. You didn't realize that in 3 months God will give you a new job, because God sometimes don't reveal everything. But for 3 months you were out of work, and you're living off all whatever savings you had. And then she has to sacrifice everything, and then for you, oh thank you, and she has to sacrifice for you. And then in the end you endure. Finally, you got your new job. Would you say that at the end of 3 months you were tested and your love was tested and she loves you more? So the love grew through the hard time. Because she loved you when you had money, she had to love you when you got no money. Then, after 2 years of happy, happy love, and then suddenly she got a sickness that deformed her face. Chicken pox to the extreme. And scratch under the whole place, whole face ugly. Extreme case. And on top of that got measles, smallpox and all the poxes. And then you look at her, but you know, because men always look at face and prettiness, so you look, and would you still love her?
The character?
No, would you still love her?
Yes.
You would still choose her. You won't go to another girl. So you still love her. Yeah? So when she talked to you, let's say, you know, she was in the hospital, the bed dropped and half her mouth injured, so she talked to you like that.
Committed. Okay,
committed. So you will still choose to love her. Would you say that your love will have grown? Okay. So by miracle of God, God miraculously healed her. And then because of this move, got restored, so she got the pretty face back. 4 years later, because you didn't watch your diet, you had a stroke. You're paralyzed half. And you go, so, and it's very hard to take care of you. You need help in every area. You could hardly walk. And so she's really tested, and it took you 1 year to fully recover. That 1 year was tough, and she go through during that 1 year she got 3 people and her your in-law tell you give him up, divorce him, she still choose you. And then one handsome rich person woo her, she still choose you. Don't forget, you also out of work. Would you say at the end of the 4th to 5th year, after the 5th year you fully recover and you look your handsome self again, because half stroke doesn't look nice, would you say your love is so deep, much deeper? Okay, so you see, it is love grows through tribulation. Through tribulation, love has to be tested. Love has to be tested, and then you say Paul encountered Jesus, and his ability to encounter Jesus. I'll give you Romans 5. So when he encountered Jesus, the more revelation he received, he also encountered demon power. So we have 2 Corinthians 12. When Paul encountered demon powers, and Paul also have the word, and you remember Matthew 13, persecution rise because of the word. So Paul have visions, and Paul also have the word. As both keep increasing, life get more and more difficult, because the devil will persecute not just directly. When he say the fallen angel buffet him, punch him, there is a law that I know in the spirit, which is this. Spirit beings, whether good or bad, are not allowed to interfere in a natural realm without explicit permission from the Father and without going through certain protocol. So an evil spirit cannot just jump on someone. Because evil spirit, if they can possess people right now, they will straight away possess everyone. There's a protocol that must be followed. The person must give in and yield. And God did give permission for the devil to touch Job, and for the fallen angel to buffet. God has to give permission in order to test Paul. So the more word he has, the more difficult his life is. As you know, Job had a difficult life also. And the devil, very clever, killed all the family except his wife, because his wife was making his life miserable. So the devil strategized, if he kill her, no one close enough to make his life miserable. Because his wife keeps saying, curse God and die. So that was useful to the enemy. So the devil didn't remove her out of the picture. Now at any moment, Paul could go back to his old ways and have a good life. He was well trained, respected, also skillful. So we realize that Paul's encounter with Jesus could stop. Level 1, level 2, level 3, level 4. Each level up will be tested severely. To receive more revelation, he must pass through tremendous suffering. Then when he passed, God gives the next level. And they will try to steal the word. At level 2, God gave him level 2 word, he will be punched and they will try to get the word. If he could hold on to the level 2 word long enough, it will become his. If he give up, there will bear no fruit. Mark the story of the sower and the word, the principle. If he let go, no roots. So the word won't belong to him. So we realize the level of revelation that Paul had is limited by his suffering. Paul would not have the revelation about Melchizedek, who he was. Paul would not be able to write the epistles he write with such revelation, because he could stop. And let me tell you, it is true today. Thank you for these points anyway for us to discuss, because good for everyone. A lot of ministers are willing to suffer only to level 1. Because they're not willing to suffer level 2, they don't have level 2 revelation. Whatever revelation God wants to give, God has to be fair. God does not play favoritism. So anyone willing to suffer level 2, get level 2 revelation. Level 3, get level 3 revelation. Level 4, get level 4 revelation. Most people by level 2, they look around, see fallen angel, don't want to go further. Because of their own fear. I had encountered fallen angels before, met them face to face. And before Jesus appeared to me, 1 week before Jesus appeared to me, in 1986, a fallen angel appeared. Did not frighten me. I pressed on. But if I got frightened and stopped pursuing God, that's it. Revelations, word, is based on our willingness to face our fear. to face things we're not willing to face before. Before I went to Australia, after my own failure, I always acknowledge my own failure. See, when a person is willing to talk about their past as an illustration, you know they got over it. If they're hiding it, then they haven't got over it. So in my own moral failure in Malaysia, I was given a few cushy choices. In fact, New Creation Church wanted me to be with them. Jack, who is in charge there, contacted me and said, "Hey, you got nowhere to go, can join us." That's 1986. I had an offer from another Malaysian friend who says, "Come over here and help us." I had an offer of a secular job from a multi-millionaire. I said no to all those things because I said, in my failure, I want to post-mortem my failure. I need to understand why I failed, why I yielded the enemy, plus I need to rebuild my home and family. My home and family is worth more than millions of dollars. My children's lives are worth more than millions of dollars. And I am not after physical wealth or a cushy life. If I wanted a cushy life, I would never enter the ministry in the first place. So I was still concerned about my standing with God. So that's why I chose to go to a place where no one will know me. No one will know who I am. I can be an ordinary person rebuilding my life. Because of my fame, when I went there, and I wanted to sit under another ministry, the Assemblies of God over all of Australia, the top, what we call, the board of the whole of Australia, Assemblies of God, had to make a decision to accept me under probation. So I went through the proper channel, and one of the main members supported me and says, "Okay, I'll take him in." He was a pastor in Canberra at that time. So I choose that road because I need to look into myself. I need to find out. And I also felt that when you have a moral failure, you should step out for a while. You don't just continue like nothing happened. So it's the right thing to do. Nobody is to tell me that. So I stepped out of the ministry for at least 2-3 years. Totally out. And it was the right thing to do. And of course, during that time, within 6 months, the angel appeared to me and showed me about the 1 week vision of 1 week before Jesus coming. So I knew that there's something there that God has for me. But I was willing to examine every doctrine I had and every thing that we teach. I said, I wonder whether all our Christianity fundamentals that we have need to be re-examined. And I was willing to re-examine everything. So I was more willing and prepared to examine everything we have of all our traditions and all that, and open so God could use that time when I'm willing to examine everything to begin to pour new revelation. And begin to examine all my bad doctrines. So he started doing that. In those 10 years. I call that the 10 years of blood. It seems to be my predestination to bring me into that area. So sometimes we have to go through certain things in order to receive more. God has to break us down first before we are willing to be built up again. And before that, I would have been just planting normal mega churches. We just keep evangelizing, keep doing the things like signs and wonders and operate the thing and just keep going bigger and bigger and have fantastic systems to follow up people and all those things. But I realized everything must be re-examined. So it took me time. It took me time before I came back to the ministry. So by the time he came back, was quite a few years' time. And went to secular work and just did what I could there. So the encounter of Jesus has to grow. By the time I was coming back in 2006, God took me to heaven. And that trip to heaven changed all my theology. And I realized there were many things that I could do better. And the understanding of predestination and pre-existence, all that I became open to. Which I was not open to if I would continue as a megachurch pastor. So I realized that the sufferings and all that you go through. And now when you make a mistake, you suffer for your mistakes. But when people still persecute you for things that are way in your past, that becomes suffering also. Because it is now injustice. See, it's unjust to persecute a person for what they paid the price for. And they've gone through all these things. So the recent persecutions that come and go, I reckon I have not break any laws and I never cross any physical, moral laws. And I was very open to analyze myself. The only misunderstanding you can have is my mental and emotional state, which you cannot prosecute a person for. You cannot prosecute a person for an email they wrote. There's no court in town. It is, it might be misinterpreted, but there's no court that can put you in jail for an email you wrote on what you call a relationship situation. Nothing to do with fraud or nothing to do with breaking any laws. Because you can be prosecuted for an email if it's a terrorist, if it's a plot, it's breaking the law. But no one can prosecute you for an email where you wrote that you have feelings for another person or you're discussing some area of love relationship. There's no court in town. Which is why I say I stand my ground, because I know where the line is. Now, I also know, should I cross the physical line and fall again into actual physical relationship, I have no more chance. Which is why I would never do that. So all the accusations in town that says, you know, they fall again and that, they don't know the details. Just that they don't know Jesus was born in Bethlehem. No one asked a question. And that is why, you know, we already have record, we have uploaded in our website a whole meeting where we discuss each of those things, each of those accusations. And then I ask the question, okay, can you define what is the actual sin? So the only sin they can try to define is, oh, perhaps it's a mental thing. Okay, for that contextual, what was the context behind the thing? Have you left your relationship? You know, as far as you're concerned, where is that, where is everything is concerned? So these are the areas. So that is why. And we're discussing, you know, some things also at one time. And then we're saying, that's why I stand firm. And so we said, okay, you want to go, you go. We're going to build. And one thing, God has never left me. Do you think God will remain with a person who actually sinned? Of course He won't. Because God is a holy God. He will not tolerate any sin. Not in the heart, not in the mind. And may I say, whatever was done with the permission of God. I asked the Lord, are you sure this is okay? The Lord said, in His sight, that's okay. With men, they do not understand. Because for God, certain things are over when the human side is not over yet. So, it's important. Now, when we go to heaven, you know, everything is clearer. On the earth, things are muddled. But we look at this part. Sufferings, different things, and people living a life difficult for you. And I remember, like when and you continue to experience betrayal and all those things. When I was going to start a church in Sydney for the first time before coming here, we are re-establishing ourselves in Sydney. One of the young pastors keep coming to visit me in Canberra. He wanted to give up the ministry. So I said, well, what's happening? And he was having problem with his father-in-law, who was also a pastor. And then in the end, I said, okay, I'm willing to take over your church. So it's like a church offer for me to take over. I said, I have certain conditions. So I went to preach in the church. And everybody liked it, and the leaders liked it. And so we went through the normal leadership meeting of taking over and all those things. And so when everything was all ready for the takeover, the father-in-law, who is out of the picture, came back. And said, why are you giving the church away, blah, 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 and all this. And then, at the last minute, influenced the son-in-law not to give the church, and it split the leadership. Nothing to do with me. The leadership was split because some of them say a decision is made, now you're going backwards. And so there was a split. And then because of what the father-in-law did, a few years later, the father-in-law died, just dropped dead like that. And because he has caused more persecution for that. And then the father-in-law wanted to dig my past, and I had to defend myself all over again. I gave all the statements and all those things from the past. I said, okay, read all these things for yourself. And then the leaders were there. I said, okay, there's nothing. It's been, no, everything that way. People like to dig the past. So when they did that, I said, this is unjust. And said, Lord, you know. 2 years later, the father-in-law, who is a pastor, dropped dead and died. But it was to the advantage of son-in-law, because now the son-in-law inherit the father-in-law's property and church. And today they're still continuing. The strange thing is that during the rebellion in 2015 here, some of those who left COG actually joined back to their church, forgetting the history of what took place. And but I have always said this, where injustice takes place, we don't have to do anything, because there's a God who is watching. But we ourselves must live right in our own conscience with God. And the fear of God in our life must be so strong. And some of the very people who sit in the front row, and when we were Golden Mount, see visions. In their vision, they themselves are the one who see, approve, and saw whatever things were going on in the spirit and whatever relationships with what we call soulmate kind of thing. They themselves saw it. But when they persecute, they drop everything that they saw. So there's a lot of stories to all those things. The only difference between them and me is this: I follow the vision. But of course, if I do evaluate, there are some things that I would say I trust people easily, which is a big weakness in my life, that I would trust the person. So one of the things that I have rearranged is, because I don't have a suspicious gene. I don't have the suspicious gene. And so I always tell the leaders around me, okay, you guys have to watch, you know, because out of the goodness of my heart, I see people as good. And so, but this life that is difficult in this road, is part of what makes you stronger. Because if I see God reveal something, I accept it. And then I will move forward with it. And like I say in the past, if nobody moves forward, I will still keep moving. And I let everybody take time to catch up. But as for myself, I must keep moving forward with whatever God reveals. But anyway, you know, all that we've seen, you know, all the prediction that people say, you know, and they take all kinds of wild pictures that were not true. Spread all kinds of wild rumors that are totally untrue. And here's the thing. Some of them, I have come to my house, I cook for them, eat with them, and I was telling Jehuda, you know, 3 years, they've seen my character, they've seen how I care for the people. And then when they leave, they paint a totally different picture. How can a person, how does a person hide their true character for 3 years under the same roof? Not possible. So then they paint a totally different picture, which is completely against God. And I say, God would never use a person who loves sin for his ministry. Person must love holiness and choose the road of holiness. And even though I might have failed myself in different areas in the past, I still do not base holiness on substandard things. I still put, that's the standard of God. Those were my failures. But the standard is still here. We do not lower the standards. So here, encounter with Jesus does grow. Remember, when Paul was willing to go to Jerusalem to be imprisoned, Jesus appeared. If Paul had followed the advice of the disciples who prophesied in Acts 21 and the interpretation of Agabus' prophecy, you see, even a prophecy can be misinterpreted, a vision or dream, and he had gone the opposite direction from Jerusalem because they all were telling him, don't go to Jerusalem. And if Paul goes somewhere else, he will be outside God's perfect will. But by willing to go through Jerusalem in God's perfect will, he's going to be imprisoned. And for him, that was the road he must take in order to bear witness to all the governors, rulers, and to Caesar himself out of that incident. So the moment he was in prison, Jesus appeared to him to confirm the direction that he has to move. So encounters with Jesus stop if you walk outside different roads. There's another book by Annie, the Iroquoian woman now, a book of visions, I Saw Heaven. Inside, she tells many, many visions of how God keep offering his people a glory, and that glory involves suffering and hard time, and doesn't look so nice, look rough and like the wilderness. The other path looks so easy, but the other path lead to lesser glory, and it's still for people to choose. The path to greater glory is also still the path of suffering and hardship. And many people don't dare to choose because they only see the outward. They don't see the ultimate. So, encounter with Jesus is the same. Through the many times that Jesus has appeared to me, I have understood one thing. When Jesus appeared to you and actually talked to you, it is because you know how much you must suffer for him. Because Jesus does not appear easily to people who do not suffer. I don't suffer, it's not. But the moment people are not willing to suffer, even the person with open visions is minimized. Before the first seven thunders came into this move, all he saw were his guardian angels and demons. Only when he came to this move and is willing to also suffer for Jesus, did he have other things. The day he stepped out, I can guarantee you, all those visions disappear. Because we are linked into this move. And the same, that when people who got gifts of vision, when they come from other places, they come here, it is stirred up. Because it is tied to God's calling and this move. And this move, I can guarantee you, is born out of suffering and tears. I've cried, I believe, more than many humans cry. If you haven't cried until there's a pool, and it's a carpet. I remember on that day when I was rejected because of my preaching the word of faith. When the word of faith was persecuted in Asia, I was associated with it. And a big door closed. That was before we started going in a different direction in church planting. Because I was just para-church. I knelt down in that afternoon service. It was our last service. And I cried on the carpet until the carpet was wet in front of me and there's a pool of water formed. This move has always been born in tears and in suffering. But through all those, I have only one constant word. Jesus, I still love you. And I will still follow you to the ends of the earth. That's why God chose. Because He knows that my encounter with Jesus is real. When Jesus appeared to me, Jesus never told me that 6 months later I had to leave the very church that I was planting to plant another one. It was a difficult decision. See, sometimes Jesus knows how much suffering is involved, so He comforts you by actually appearing to you. So Jesus does not appear that easily. He chooses. Because we are supposed to have the Word and angels and all that. Even if angels work closely with you, there is suffering involved. So the supernatural comes at a price. Then we have, what is Paul's success? We know that you cannot preach the gospel without signs and wonders. To preach signs and wonders, Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 12. And also, don't forget chapter 11, all the suffering that he went through. 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians, chapter 11. Firstly, to preach the gospel, look at his tenacity. He says, from the Jews 5 times I received 40 stripes minus one. Most people already gave up with half a stroke. Paul got 39 times 5. 3 times beaten with a rod. Some people just being threatened, they're really scared. Paul was actually beaten and he never stopped. And all these other things he suffered. Weariness and toil, hunger, thirst, fasting, cold, nakedness. I've been through times when I don't have much in my pocket and I still got to do God's ministry and I still will do it willingly and gladly. So people would have given up. And today I know there are some pastors who left the ministry to go to business because they want a better life. If they only endure, they will see God's provision. But they give up too fast. Then chapter 12 verse 12. Truly the signs of an apostle were accomplished among you with all perseverance. See the word perseverance? Signs and wonders belong to those who suffer first. Many people want signs and wonders, but they don't understand. Before God trusts you with extreme power, you must have superb character to handle it. And most people are turning back from being extremely prepared in the fiery furnace. So God cannot bring signs and wonders to them. So when we look at that, thank you, Petra. The correct answer is no, he would not have succeeded. He will succeed to a certain extent, but cannot go further. Because Jesus won't reveal more until he persecuted. And Jesus, the word also stopped. His love also stopped. His success also cannot. He cannot persevere the greater things. So it's no. For total success. He will have some success. Now, when we look at this, which we will continue in the second service, we ask you this question. Many of you want prosperity, but you want prosperity without suffering. Prosperity without suffering and without persecution is the prosperity of the world. It's the prosperity of compromise, which will destroy both you, your character, and everything you hold dear. But the prosperity that comes from the Lord comes through suffering. If you're willing to suffer, then God builds you the character, and then the prosperity comes. The prosperity won't destroy you. And in number one, many people want a ministry without suffering. It is not God's way. Everyone must have the wilderness. And here you see the key. None of us might be sent into the wilderness like Jesus for 40 days. But God in His mercy has spread out the training of suffering instead of putting it in a concentrated 40-day form. Because not many people can stand that. But whatever God has given you of your portion, if you are not passing it, you have your own answer why you're not progressing in a ministry. So this is prosperity, this ministry, and this is ministry success. It is okay even if it takes time. Because I know that Elijah himself, Enoch appeared to him at the age of 35. He was told to wait on God for 20 years. Then at the age of 55, he was told to go on a 7-year prayer walk. So by the time he appeared before King Ahab in 1 Kings chapter 17, he was 62 years old. The Apostle Paul went into when God first appeared to him in Acts 9, he wanted to preach, but they wanted to kill him. So according to Galatians, when they let him down in a basket, he went to Arabia and then Damascus for 3 years, when nobody knew him. After 3 years, he was introduced to the apostle, which was still in Acts 9. See, there's a gap of the 3 years. When he went to Jerusalem, the apostles still find hard to accept. Barnabas accepted him and sent him away. In the end, because they want to still kill him, he was sent to his own hometown. And he waited there for another 6 years. Another 6 years. Another 7 years to make it 10 years. So altogether, before you hear about the Apostle Paul, before he has even one church to pastor, Paul, after Jesus appeared to him, was trained for 10 years. In his hometown, he is from Tarsus, no one knew him. Balik Kampung. He was back in his hometown. The first time he came back into the ministry, the first door that opened to him was opened by Barnabas in Acts chapter 10 was Cornelius' story. In Acts 11, when Barnabas went to see the Antioch church and saw the need there, the Bible says he went to find Paul and brought Paul to the Antioch church. So that's why I say it was about 9 or 10 years, because 1 year later the Holy Spirit say, send Paul out with Barnabas. Altogether, about 10 to 11 years before his ministry publicly began. So that is why when this move began, we should not be in a hurry. Despite the fact that we got vast experience, we should wait on God to prepare all the whole world, the planet and the circumstances. And when God wants to do something, God will open a door, and then the world will begin to hear the message. So remember that everything is in God's time, but the preparation is long and tough, because in all three areas it involves suffering. But praise the Lord, these 3 years, the year 2018, 2019, and 2020, are going to be the best years every one of us has. Some people that should be here, they are not here, they're going to miss out. Those of you who endure, you are here, great rewards have been assigned for you. It is God who gives a reward. God who knows our heart. And at the end, we're beginning the next 7 years in 2020 to 2027. By the year 2027, every single one of you here, including those of you online who are still in this move, you will be so blessed and rewarded that you look back and say, thank God I never wavered. There will be many people who wavered and start coming back during the time of the open doors. And by that time, their reward is at a secondary level. Then there will be many others who regret and come back, and God will deal with them differently. So, it is good to endure. There is no need to endure if there was no persecution. There is no need to endure if there was no tribulation. God does things the opposite from the devil. You notice the devil? He offered Jesus everything in the beginning. Before he even started, he offered him the world. But for God, he offered you the world after you pass the test. That's God's method. Because we cannot handle the wealth, the fame. Any one of you who read Isaiah 60 will know this. You will be the move on the whole planet. All the wealth of the world will be handled by us. All the fame of the world will be handled by the glorious church. All the power in the world will be handled by the kingdom of God's people. And it is the greatest part of history that humans ever go through. We are privileged. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy. We ask, O God, that you establish your kingdom. That you continue, Lord, to bring us into this place where your kingdom show forth all the fullness of your grace. We recognize we are nothing. We are absolutely nothing. Only Jesus in us can bring us to the place where we can live in the fullness of God. And we are now in a transition period. We thank you for every individual here who has sacrificed, who have paid the price, who have been steadfast. And we ask that you reward each one, including their guardian angels who have strengthened them. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all rise. And God's going to reward each one of you. We're going to pray for impartation into your life. Bless these hands. Bless these hearts. Bless this mind, reward them by your mercy. Strengthen their angels. Strengthen their hearts and minds. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day. This is the hour. I will bless you, Lord, for you have blessed us, Lord. This is the day you bless your temple. Thank you, Father. Seal these blessings upon each one. Let your Holy Spirit drop gifts and impartations, the seed of their future success. They have suffered, they have endured, they have bore the pain with blood, sweat, and tears. It is now blessing time. Rewards. Give thanks. Impartations. Let it be upon each one of your people. As according to the glory each one have attained in their spirits to suffering, let your kingdom come upon each one. Thank you, Father. Establish it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. Give Jesus a good clap offering, and God bless you.